My name is Andy Schmitz. I'm a battalion chaplain for 1st Battalion, 327th Infantry Regiment. It's a joy to be with you this morning for a number of reasons. I love preaching the word, but also I'm not just preaching the word on anything. I'm preaching on church membership, and I'm not just preaching on church membership. My wife and I, immediately following this sermon on church membership, will become church members of Faith Family. So it's just a really special morning. If you'll please turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2, and we're going to read verses 11 through 22. We've already read through them once this morning, but there's just so much densely packed in these verses that it would be really helpful for us to read through it again. But then also, you as you sit here, don't play just a passive role this morning. In fact, you ought to be discerning about what's happening. You ought to be actively engaged. And as we read this text, you ought to be looking at what the Apostle Paul is saying in these verses. Because he's under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. This is God's word, him speaking himself. And my job is not to be clever or inventive and make you ooh and ah, like what a great orator Andy is. But instead, my job is to be faithful to this text. And if I'm not faithful to this word, not only should you not care what I say, but you ought to tell Kyle and Dan to never let me preach again. Bro, I have one job, and it's to be faithful to the text. But if what I say is faithful to this word, it is God speaking to us. And it comes with authority. So let's read Ephesians 2:11 through 22. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in the place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access in one Spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. Let's pray. Father, we come before you in the name of your Son, and we ask, speak, O Lord, as we come to you in your holy word. I pray that if there are any here who don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, that they would believe on him through the pouring out of your Holy Spirit. And for the saints who are here this morning, I pray you warm our affections for Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've been married, Jenna and I, for about 8 years, and a couple months ago, I got a Facebook notification that it was about 10 years ago this year that we first met. And it just made me really think about how we met and how we started dating and how unlikely it was that I would ever have actually had a chance with Jenna Prana, who turned out eventually to be Jenna Schmitz. And, I don't know, just by appearances, just to begin with, I'm about a 2. Jenna is 10. She's a 10 out of 10. She's a 12 out of 10. Jenna grew up being athletic. I grew up trying to be athletic and failing miserably, which really disappointed my dad. Like, I'm talking the 1 year I did wrestling in school, I lost every single match, like, decidedly. Jenna conquers at Scrabble. I cheat at Scrabble. And actually, by the time we started dating, I tried pursuing her. I gave her, at that time, she had already graduated from Olivet Nazarene University, moved, found a job in Scotland, found a healthy local church, gotten baptized in the North Sea, moved back to the United States of America, gotten a full-time job, and was a healthy member of her local church. And I was a 20-year-old college student growing out his neck beard, and that was all I had to boast of. And so it comes to no one's surprise that when I tried calling Jenna, she didn't pick up my call. And so then when I called her the second time, she didn't pick up my call. I called her the third time, still radio silence. And it wasn't until I called a mutual friend of ours and said, "Did I say something wrong to Jenna Prena that she is just giving me the cold shoulder?" And then he had his wife convince Jenna to return my call, and that's the only way we got the ball rolling. I just didn't have a lot going for me when it came to my likelihood of ever getting there with Jenna. In fact, I had a lot going against me. And that's Paul's point in a similar way in Ephesians 2:11. He's saying these Gentile believers in the local church in Ephesus in the first century did not have a lot going for them when it came to them ever becoming a part of God's kingdom. And not only did they not have a lot going for them, they had a lot going against them. They were not just a shoo-in to be included in God's kingdom. The deck was stacked against them. And Paul lays out at the beginning 6 ways that they were separated from God. And then what he does, he says, now that you know how far you were from God, you can appreciate what it took to reconcile you to God, namely through Christ, and that will make you appreciate the unity that you now have with God and other people in the local church. It's kind of like a big, grand overview. Now let's zoom in. If you're taking notes, here's point number one, is remember. Okay, if you're taking notes, that's point number one, is remember. Let's look at the 6 things that the Gentiles, which are non-Jews, and by extension us, that we had going against us. Here's the first thing, verse 11. Therefore remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called a circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. So pause right there. That's the first thing. Gentiles are not circumcised in the sense of this covenant circumcision promise. So if you just try to jump into the Bible and this is your first time in the story and it's Ephesians and you don't know what happened for the dozens of books that led up to this, you're going to be kind of confused. Like if you jumped into book 5 of the Harry Potter series, you didn't read the first 4. You're going to be like, who in the world is Hermione Granger? Okay, well, it's like that here. If you need to understand what happened before Ephesians to appreciate what happens in Ephesians. Namely, in the book of Genesis, in the beginning, God created everything good. In fact, without sin, he created everything perfectly, mankind included. And yet, in short order, Adam and Eve, the first man, the first woman, they disobeyed God. They sinned against him. And that sin caused separation. The whole world was plunged into chaos. The image of God was fractured in man. And we are all subsequently born in sin. And we were all broken ourselves. And yet God sets in motion a plan of redemption. He finds a random guy named Abram, and he says, I'm going to promise redemption to you. And I'm going to give you and your descendants a wonderful promise that I will make good on in the future. And the sign that I have given you this special relationship is circumcision. Now, Abraham is the patriarch, the head of what eventually become the Jewish nation. And all male Jews on the earth on the eighth day were circumcised. This was the sign that God had specially set them apart to be a light to the nations, and the Gentiles don't have that. That's Paul's first point. You're not circumcised. Here's the second thing the Gentiles had going against them. Keep reading with me in verse 11. Or verse 12. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ. These Gentiles, and by extension us, we are all born not united to Jesus. We are born separated from Jesus because of our sin, because we are born into sin and we actually sin. We are not by nature Christians. Faith doesn't come by hereditary passing it down, but instead it comes after we've been born, when we've heard the gospel, and we believe on Christ. But that's not how we start. We start out separated from Christ. That's the second thing. What's the third thing these Gentiles have going against them? Here in verse 12. They were alienated from the commonwealth of Israel. There's so much Old Testament language packed into just that one phrase. So Abraham has Isaac, who has Jacob. Jacob's renamed Israel. He has 12 sons, 12 tribes of Israel. And God richly blesses the nation of Israel. I mean, just read 1st and 2nd Kings and all the wealth and the status and the renown that God gives to this wonderful nation. You think the Commonwealth of Kentucky is great? How much greater is the common? And it's great. But the Commonwealth of Israel was greater, and the Gentiles had no access to it. At least by genealogy. They were separated from the commonwealth of Israel. That was the third thing. Fourth thing they have going against them, according to Paul, is they were strangers to the covenants of promise, is what he says here. So we've already talked about the Abrahamic covenant, this promise to do good. There's other covenants in the Old Testament. You might think of the Davidic covenant. You might think of the Mosaic covenants. Gentiles have no access to these covenants of promise. They were given to Jews, not to the Gentiles, and we have that going against us. You see, Paul's just repeatedly using all this imagery so that we will know for sure that we were separated from God. And in fact, the fifth thing that we have going against us, according to the Apostle Paul, in verse 12, he says, having no hope. Friends, by nature, none of us have any hope. Let that sink in. Few things agonize me more, and Jenna has to kind of calm me down, than when I'm at a funeral of a person who sadly has lived their entire lives in utter rebellion against God, has never professed faith in Jesus at all. And the preacher of that funeral preaches to a wide audience of everyone who's grieving here, some of whom also are not Christians, that this person is now in heaven, that they have hope, and you can have hope too, whether or not you're a Christian, is the implicit message. And it drives me nuts because you're legitimizing unbelieving lifestyles and you're leading these people to the certain grave of eternal destruction like this person may very well be in. I don't know anyone's heart myself. It's not the preacher's job necessarily to preach someone into heaven or to hell, but I certainly know that we ought to preach the truth that we have no hope by nature. And the only hope that we have is in Jesus if we believe in him. Jenna has to calm me down because I want to shout all of that in the middle of the sermon. It's not the time or the place. But this is the time and the place, so I'm telling you now. We have no hope. The sixth and final thing. This is deafening. How does he end verse 12? We are without God in the world. How many times have you heard someone say, I'm spiritual but not religious. I love practicing spirituality and meditation and mindfulness. They never actually say, I have a vibrant relationship with the living Christ. Let me tell you, on the authority of the Bible, that there is no true spirituality apart from Jesus. In fact, we're all born without God in the world. We are born dead in one sense. We are born dead in our trespasses and sin. That's exactly how Paul starts this chapter in Ephesians 2:1. We could not be more separated from God because of our sin. A holy God cannot tolerate sin in his presence. The wages of our sin is death. Make no mistake about it, beloved. We have offended this holy God. If we got what we deserved, it would be death. We have no inherent salvific value. And you can't appreciate the good news of the gospel until you've squared with the bad news of our sin. You can't appreciate how good a warm shower feels until you've been bivouacking in the field for a week without a shower. Until you've spent, like Daniel Hurd does, painting his entire head full of camouflage paints. You can't appreciate how great that... I'll show you a picture later. It's really funny. how good that feels. And how many of us just want to skip past the bad news straight to the good news? But the good news isn't sweet until you know the bitterness of the bad news of our rebellion. Oh, beloved, don't skip over this bad news, because Paul doesn't. Find me in the Bible where one of the biblical authors skips past the good news, or the bad news, to get to the good news. No, it's always, here's our rebellion against the holy God, but then God does for us what we can't do for ourselves through his Son. That's always the pattern. It should be the pattern in our evangelism. It can't just be kicked off and only God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. That's just not what the biblical authors say to begin with. Say, God is holy, we've sinned, and then they get to the good news. These Gentiles, us included, were separated from God. Even, think of this in the Old Testament, think of the temple, even in like the old temple structure, there was separation. One biblical commentator says, there was an inscription on the wall of the outer courtyard of the Jerusalem temple warning Gentiles that they would only have themselves to blame for their death if they passed beyond it into the inner courts. Paul may or may not have been alluding to this wall, but it well illustrates Christ's reconciliation of all people into a new humanity. Friends, we are separated from God. We had a lot going against us. We are not born children of God. We're made in the image of God. We're not born children of God. In fact, look back with me in verse 3 of chapter 2. Paul says, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. We are born children of wrath, sons of disobedience. We are not by nature children of God. We are at enmity towards God from our first cry. It takes the new birth to become a child of God, bought with the precious blood of Jesus. When God looks at us in our sin, in our rebellion, in our deadness, he is offended. A holy God is righteously angry against sin and sinners. We ought not to separate the two. If we got what we deserve, it would be eternal, conscious torment. We would never be able to repay our debt against God. We would never be able to pay the full penalty for our offense against our Creator. That is why hell is eternal. There is, did you read it when we read through the text that Jesus eliminates hostility? For Jesus to eliminate hostility, that means there is hostility just by default. There is hostility between us and God. God is hostile toward us. The other day I was checking my email in my office, in my Army unit. Just a normal office environment, right? Well, no. Some specialist had gotten a ticket for not buckling his seatbelt, and it was on post. And so I heard just like the next room over, paper thin walls, some first sergeant exploding in hostile anger against this specialist. And I'm just like, oh my goodness, I'm just trying to check my email. It was a hostile work environment, and that is but a shadow of God's hostility against us. And woe to us if we attempt to downplay that hostility. Paul certainly isn't. We shouldn't either. I love how Paul structures this text. He really stacks the bad news, bad news, bad news, and it makes you really, really long for good news. He did it earlier in Ephesians 2. He says, we were dead in our trespasses and sin. We are children of wrath like the rest of mankind. And then in verse 4, he says, but God, being rich in mercy and in love, with the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together in Christ. And in our text this morning, Paul has the same transition of a but God. So point number one was remember. Point number two is but now. Read that with me in verse 13. I'm not making this up. So bad news, bad news, bad news. We had so much going against us when it came to our likelihood of ever being a child of God. But now, verse 13, in Christ. In Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in the flesh the dividing wall of hostility. How did he do this? By abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in the place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. What is Paul saying here? God killed the hostility by killing his son. That's what he's saying. Make no mistake about it, friend. Either we will be killed by God for our sin, or Jesus was killed in our place, and we have trusted in him. And there is no other option. Either God has put his son to death in our stead, or he will put us to death. That's what the text is saying. And it's true. We can't save ourselves. We've already sinned. No amount of attempts of do-gooding can improve our situation. We already have to pay for the sin we've already committed. And each and every one of us, we have sinned. Whether by loving ourselves more than loving God, by breaking his commandments, by thinking more highly of ourselves as we ought to, I really need to convince you that we've made a mess of our lives. I know I have. And even what we might think of a minor sin, even a minor sin against an infinitely holy God is infinitely offensive. And only God can remedy this. And he has, by sending his son, Jesus Christ, who's truly God and truly man. He was born of the Virgin Mary. We're going through that in the Gospel of Luke, which is really exciting. Jesus, as he lived his earthly life, he was tempted in every way like you and I have been tempted. And yet, unlike us, Jesus never sinned. There's no deceit found in his mouth. Jesus perfectly obeyed and fulfilled the law. He abolished the law expressed in ordinances, the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians 2. Jesus racked up perfect righteousness on our behalf. Jesus succeeds where we have failed. That's good news. I am saved not by my performance, but by Jesus' performance on my behalf. My boast is not in my works, but in Christ and Christ alone. But Jesus was more than just a righteous person. He did more than just teach good things, although he did both. In the fullness of time, he was sent to the cross. More happened at the cross than Roman guards nailing him to it. More happened at the cross than Jews mocking him. God the Father poured his wrath out on his Son in the place of everyone who would repent of their sins and trust in him. Through the blood of the cross, the hostility between us and God was paid for in full. Jesus' last words on the cross, that he says with his last breath, "It is finished." That's good news. Jesus has paid for my sin debt in full. I get his righteousness. He paid for my sin. I am fully forgiven in Christ. And you are too, if you turned away from your sin and trusted in him alone. And he didn't stay dead. On the third day, he was raised in victory over Satan, over sin, and over death. Jesus, it's not as true that you invite Jesus into your life. Instead, Jesus invites you into his life. Our life is a mess. His life is glorious and resurrected. Oh, beloved, do you share in this resurrected life of Christ? Would you rest from your labors of trying and failing to save yourself and trust in Jesus alone? He ascended, he's coming again, and now he, Paul says in verse 17, he preaches peace. He preaches peace to those who are far off and peace to those who are near. The only Son of God died so that children of wrath could become children of God. Can I say that one more time? The only Son of God died so that children of wrath could become children of God. How wonderful, how glorious that those who are far off and those who are near have, both of them have peace preached to them. Which contextually, Paul is writing as a Jew to Gentiles. These Gentiles who were far off, the Jews had more proximity to the covenants of promise, but they both need peace preached to them. There's no one in this world that doesn't need peace preached to them. Whether it's the hardened sinner, maybe that's you, this is your first time even hearing the good news of Jesus. You've walked in sin your entire life. You've tasted the bitterness of reaping what you've sown. Like, your life is a mess. You hate it. You're grieved over it. But not because it's offended a holy God, but because it makes difficulty for you. You need peace preached to you, but also the person who grew up as a goody-two-shoes, going to church, grew up singing, "Yes, Jesus loves me," who grew up going to vacation Bible school. Maybe you've even gone on mission trips. Maybe you've been baptized. Maybe you have all the trappings and appearances of being in the covenant community, but while you fooled everyone else, and maybe you, in some way you fooled yourself, you know, deep down in your heart, you've never actually trusted in Jesus. Your heart is cold towards him. You're not actually grieved over your sin because it's offended a holy God. You're good at playing cultural Christianity, but your affections, what you love, is not God himself. You love what that gets you socially when you profess to be a believer. Friend, you need peace preached to you as well, even if you are near, because there's still hostility between you and God. Whether we are rank and file sinners or we're good at appearing righteous, God sees straight to both of those kind of people's hearts. He sees our sin, and Jesus died in the place of both so long as we would turn from it and embrace him as our treasure. He's reconciled us both, Jew and Gentile, verse 16, both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. It took the death of the Son of God to reconcile us to him and to one another. It's weird that Daniel and I wear on our uniforms crosses. We've grown so accustomed to it. Because it symbolizes the execution of the only Son of God. It's not cute and cuddly. It's devastating and costly. It's as offensive as wearing a noose as our symbol. Or a gallows. Or a firing squad. Some symbol that symbolizes that. It's the cross where Jesus paid for our sins. This is what God has done for us, what we couldn't do for ourselves. And each member of the Trinity was involved in it. Did you notice that in verse 18? For through him, through Jesus, we both, Jews and Gentiles, have access in one spirit to the Father. You can read in chapter 1 of Ephesians, Paul's already illustrated the role of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in the gospel of Jesus. Each of them work in concert with the other one. So we believe in one God, three persons. God the Father makes the plan of redemption. Jesus the Son does the work of redemption through his cross. And the Holy Spirit applies the work of redemption to the saints. Friends, each member of the Trinity is making much of God by saving sinners like me and you. That's good news. Oh, beloved, don't underestimate the depth of our sin in the sight of the Holy God. We did not first choose him, obey him, love him, or seek him. Instead, he did all of those for us. Here's my third point. Holy temple. Holy temple. Read with me starting in verse 19. So Paul's applying what we just learned. What do we do with this? So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. Friends, this is really glorious good news because he's using even more Old Testament imagery here. He's using a lot of temple language. So if you think back to the Old Testament, the dwelling place between God and man where God's people could gather, hear the word, the high priest would enter and offer sacrifice for sin. This God's presence in the Old Testament was locative. It was in the temple with his people Israel. Now, Paul's saying Jesus has fulfilled that in his body. Jesus, the God-man, is the divine meeting place between God and man. It is in him that we have relationship with God. And if you've believed on Christ, then you are in Christ. That's good news. And we don't just have our own one-way relationship with God. It's something that instead we do together. Did you notice that? Two are becoming one. Our salvation is personal, but it is not individualistic. Can I say that again? Our salvation is personal, but it is not individualistic. God himself exists in community of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is a holy fellowship full of joy, and he has reconciled different people together in him, in his Son. Our salvation experience is done in community with one another and the Holy God. Paul even is writing this not to an individual person, but to a group of saints in a local church. And this fits the pattern of the rest of the New Testament. You won't find in the New Testament Lone Ranger Christians. You will find meaningful faithful members of the local church. In fact, you just read the normal pattern. Someone hears the gospel, they see Jesus is glorious, and they're convicted of their sins, and they hear that they can be forgiven. They turn away from sin, trust in him. They're born again. They're then baptized upon their profession of faith into membership in the local church. And they are shepherded by pastors and other church members. There's immediate involvement and entrance into this local church of which Jesus Christ himself is the cornerstone. This is God's plan from the beginning, that we would be a part of the local church of Christ. In fact, at the end of an exalted first chapter, that's how Paul ends Ephesians 1. Read this from verse 22 and 23 of Ephesians 1. And the Father put all things under Jesus' feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Friends, we are made, as Paul says at the end of chapter 2, we are made members of the household of God. Our reconciliation with God means reconciliation and family dynamic with one another. And that's glorious. Vertical relationship with God necessarily means horizontal relationship with one another. This is what Paul is saying. He's speaking as a Jew to Gentiles. He's saying the gospel of Jesus Christ reconciles people who are totally different from one another into the same family through the same blood of Jesus. In fact, you could say Ephesians 2:11 through 22 is all about racial reconciliation. These are two different ethnicities, two different nationalities, reconciled into one new family. And what better name for that kind of family than Faith Family Church? I mean, you must have been reading Ephesians 2 when you came up with this name. This is a faith family church made up of a people of different ethnicities, different backgrounds. And the gospel conquers even ethnic division, class division. Don't you love it when Paul says, we love this text, don't we, in Galatians 3, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. Last year I was discipling a member of my church. His name's Ken. Ken's black, if you can guess it. I'm not. We were reading a book called Knowing God by J.I. Packer. And in one of the chapters, J.I. Packer says, and it threw me off at first, that justification, the doctrine of justification, is not the highest privilege that the gospel offers. That us being counted right in God's sight is not the highest privilege. Adoption is. Friends, you and I are not just regarded as acquitted in God's sight as a holy judge. We are regarded as his children together. We refer to God not just as a distant deity, but as Father, is what Paul is saying here in Ephesians 2. He is our Father. Jesus Christ is our elder brother. The Holy Spirit is the spirit of adoption, which means Ken and I are siblings in the same family. It's a brother from another mother. So you think about the most radical differences you could ever have with someone and just fill in the blank. The gospel conquers that. Blue collar, white collar, enlisted officer, white, black. You're a fan of the Tennessee Titans, or more appropriately the Ohio State Buckeyes. The most radical differences are smaller than the gospel that unites us in the local church. Reconciliation with God vertically means unity with members of the local church horizontally. I wonder if you're here and you're a skeptic, you're an unbeliever, this is kind of new to you. I wonder, how do you make sense of just a church gathering like this? Where even in this room, there are different ethnicities here. And we're all singing the same praise songs. We're all sitting under the same word. And it really seems like we are a family. How do you make sense of that? How do you make sense of, for example, the Sheerans? Like, maybe it's easy to understand, like, hey, American-Canadian, I can deal with that. But then, like, you look at their children, and you're just like, one of these things does not look like the other, and because they adopted a child from South Korea. Why would they do something like that? Well, it's because they believe in the gospel, in which Jesus laid down his life and ransomed the people from every tongue and tribe and nation. This is who the kingdom of God is made up by. It's people who don't have anything else in common other than Jesus Christ himself. That's glorious. Why else would you go to a different country like Honduras and preach the gospel to Hondurans? Do we even have the right to do that? Is that just our kind of like white patriarchal go to this country? Like, no. We not only are allowed to, we ought to. Jesus says, go and make disciples of all nations. There's people in every people group that I've paid for their sin with my own blood. Go and preach that good news to them. Oh, beloved. The local church is the gospel made visible. As one pastor said. And because the local church is the gospel made visible, let me ask you four questions about the local church. I'll ask you four questions just by way of application and conclusion. And to help me, I'm going to use Hebrews 13:17 to kind of apply it to our hearts pastorally. I'll just read Hebrews 13:17. Says, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have to give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you. Tracking? Okay, here's question number one. Are you a member of a local church? Are you a member of a local church? Let me just say that in the New Testament, there isn't a believer who isn't a member of a local church in a normal way. And yet, when I compare what is biblically normal versus what we see in our day, in our country, there's a lot of people who claim, I'm a Christian, but not a member of a local church. I don't need a brick and mortar building to practice my spirituality. You can only say that if you don't read your Bible. Because when people believe in Jesus Christ in the Bible, they become members of a local church. They submit to the authority of the local church. And I wonder, if you're not a member of the local church, how do you obey Hebrews 13:17 when it says obey your leaders? In context, it means pastors. Can I ask that again? If you're not a member of a local church, how do you obey Hebrews 13:17 when it says submit to your pastors? Which pastors do you submit to if you're not a member of the local church? Especially if you're doing like a buffet style, you rotate churches each Sunday. Do you submit to all pastors everywhere? If you have a prayer request, you call up some pastor from, I don't know, Alabama, and he's like, I don't know you from Adam. Like, that just wouldn't work out too well, right? Church membership clarifies who we submit to. Are you a member of a local church? Do you think you're some sort of exception? Let me just say, with a master of divinity to back it up, it's weird to not be a member of a local church. That's the most theologically accurate term. It's weird that you're not a member. And if you're not a member of a local church, you ought to be a member of a local church. And by the way, Jenna and I are going to make good on that ought to be right after this sermon. It's kind of awkward. We will become a member, I promise, in like 10 minutes. Second question. If you are a member, what kind of member are you? If you are a member of a local church, what kind of member are you? Did you notice in Hebrews 13:17, it says, obey, submit to your leaders. They're going to give an account for your souls. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you. So certainly there's application to pastors like Kyle, Dan, and Kent. You ought to be shepherding with joy because Jesus shepherded with joy. Joyless pastors are fraud because they don't look like Jesus. But this was written to church members. Let your pastors shepherd you with joy. They're going to give an account. So we bear responsibility, beloved, to help our pastor shepherd us with joy. It's in our best interest, is what the author of Hebrews is saying. Are you the type of church mentor who's constantly looking for ways to encourage and refresh your pastors? Or are you the type of church member who's constantly adding weight to the hearts and shoulders of your elders? Now, don't get me wrong, it's a joy to be shepherded. Like I can speak, I was a pastor for 5 years. I loved taking care of weak and wounded saints. I love it. But it unnecessarily weighed down my heart if there was like a constant problem member who was distracting us from the gospel, distracting us from making disciples, who they were just chronically in patterned sin and selfishness. Beloved, I would encourage you. It's in your best interest. Let them do this with joy. Third question. Do you see the local church as more of a restaurant or family meal? Do you see it more as a restaurant meal or family meal? Here's the difference. Maybe today you're going to go out to a restaurant for lunch or for dinner. You're going to be served by a server. They're going to come and take your order. They're going to make food, and that food prep you have no part in. They're going to bring out your food. They're going to serve you. And when you're done, they're going to take the dishes off your table. You're not going to do that. That's a restaurant meal. Like if you need a refill on a glass, you might kind of like wave your hand and like get their attention, and they'll come over and take care of you. Now, what happens if you try to do that in a family meal? Like your glass runs out of water. You kind of like to your mom, like, hey, can I get some more water over here? She's going to be like, get it yourself, right? Like you just can't take that approach to a family meal. The difference is whether you expect to be served or to serve. And the Lord Jesus in Mark 10:25 says that he himself came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Friends, the local church is a faith family. It's a family of faith where we ought to strive to image Christ by serving the people he's already served by shedding his own blood for them. Don't you get more joy from serving others than selfishly demanding that they serve you? Now, it's a joy to have my burdens borne by other members of the local church. Yes and amen. But I get more joy by pouring my life out in response to Jesus pouring his life out for me and pouring my life out for others. Do you see the church as an opportunity to be served or to serve? And last question, how do you talk about other members of the local church? How do you talk about or to members of the local church? Here's the reason I'm asking that. So we saw at the end of Ephesians 2 that we are being built together as a holy temple in the Lord, that this is what local church membership is. We're being built together by the Holy Spirit. So it's like architectural building language. There's another time in the book of Ephesians that Paul uses that language of being building together. It's Ephesians 4:29. Let me read this. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. Did you notice he's saying your speech ought to fit building up? Paul's using this in the same way. So if you're thinking, how can I build up a local church? Friends, the way you ought to do that is with your speech. Jesus, the living word, speaks grace upon grace to us. Woe to us if our language tears down the people that he's given grace to. Few things will tank a local church faster than gossip. And Kyle isn't like giving me the inside scoop like, Andy, make sure you get him with this. Like, that's not what this is. I just know we all have a proclivity to talk about people instead of to people. And the biblical pattern is, if someone has sinned, then you ought to go between you and them alone. Don't bring anyone else into it. And lovingly and humbly and carefully rebuke them and remind them of the gospel. And that's a sweet reconciliation that comes from that. May we use our language not to tear other people down, but to build them up in Jesus Christ. Oh, beloved, we had a lot going against us. our selfishness, our sin, idolatry. We were by nature lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. But God chose us in eternity past so that we would praise the glory of his grace. And he sent his Son because of the great love with which he loved us, so that we who are far off have now been brought near, and we're even now being built together with one another as a spiritual family into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit.